Hi viewers, welcome to Crazy for DB. In this video we are going to discuss about implicit cursor. This is third video in the series of study of PL SQL cursors. The link for other two which you must watch has been provided in the description box. Let us first lay the agenda for this video. There are 5 points we are going to study in this video about the implicit cursors. First is, what is meant by implicit cursor? Which SQL statements can be used under implicit cursor? Exceptions associated with the implicit cursor. Then we will see example of the use of implicit cursor. And finally, we are going to see the where current of clause, which is an important clause associated with the implicit cursors when we want to update or delete the data using those statements. Now, the first question that we are supposed to answer as per the agenda is, what is meant by implicit cursor? A cursor which is not declared. So, an implicit cursor's first property is that it is not declared, but directly used in the body of the PL SQL block. Without any prior declaration, you directly write it below the begin keyword, that is the executable section of the block. And when we do that, this is called as an implicit cursor. That is what actually we mean by implicit cursor. Implicit cursors are opened and closed automatically by Oracle. So there are no any open, fetch, close statements associated with the implicit cursors, because that process is done implicitly, that is internally by the Oracle system. Then every DML statement executed is provided with a context area in PG and hence in turn has a cursor. So obviously, when we want to perform any DML operation, the data or the blocks containing the data are fetched in the memory, and obviously that is actually the part of the memory called as context area in the PGA, and hence obviously there is a pointer to that context area getting created where the program focus will lie, and hence in turn it has to be called as a cursor, and that is implicit cursor. Now, which statements can be used as implicit cursor? As we have seen, under the explicit cursor, the link for which has been given, as I already said, in the description box, and you may visit that video also if you have not done so far. Then, there you have used only select statements, whereas there are 4 types of statements you can use under the implicit cursors, that is select statement with certain limitations of course, then insert, update and delete. So together they may be called as the DML statement. So we can say select, that is query statement, and the 3 DML statements we can use as the implicit cursor. Now there are certain special exceptions associated with the implicit cursor. There are 2 exceptions as you can see listed over here, that is no data found and too many rows. A plain select statement which is not in bulk collect form has restriction of compulsion of fetching exactly 1 row. So that is the limitation, but that limitation is only for the select statement, and it should not have the bulk collect, it should not take the bulk collect form. So what should be the form of the select statement which would have these exceptions? And that is this form you can see over here, select column list, that is projection of the select into obviously variable list here, or you can use the percent row type or record type variable as the as per the requirement, whatever is suitable. Then from table name, and the where clause, obviously, which has been indicated in the square brackets, is optional. So if the select statement is of this particular form, then it is necessary, it is imperative, it is compulsory on this select statement to fetch only one row. I said compulsorily it must fetch only a single row. It means that if it fetches no rows, then there is an exception, no data found, as you can see over here. Or if it fetches more than one rows, then there is an exception, too many rows. And this is obvious because you have got only one variable list over here. And so if there are multiple rows getting fetched because of this improper where clause, then you cannot have multiple rows getting stored in just one set of variables or one variable of record type or percent row type. So that is the logic behind this. And so this too many rows exception is quite logical to understand. But there is one important thing that you have to note down, is that these two exceptions are not applicable to the DML statement. They are only applicable to the select statement of the above form. So what does it mean? It means that these operations, that is insert, update and delete, these operations can be done over any number of rows, including no rows. So that is the actual repercussion of these two exceptions, and they are applicable to the select statement only of this form and not of bulk collect form. Bulk collect has not been considered over here in this exercise because it is related to creating a collection type attribute, and collection type attribute is not part of this video, and the same will be covered in another video, and you can keep on visiting to study that video as well. Now explicit cursor that is actually about the explicit cursor, and here this explicit cursor is used for update no wait clause, and that ensures as the program loops through the records of the cursor, they are available for transaction and not locked by any other session. The program will exit immediately on open if exclusive locks cannot be obtained. So that is a part of the explicit cursor for requesting locks. This particular part should be actually related to the explicit cursor and not the implicit cursor. Now we come to the example for implicit cursor. Example for implicit cursor, here we are considering one simple problem, and that problem basically is to update the salary of employees of given department with given amount of increment. So this is the problem that we are going to solve with the implicit cursor. Update salary of employees of given department with given amount of increment. This is the program code that we have written over here. We will take this code to the Oracle environment. I will explain it over there. Now, as you can see here, this is the declaration section having certain variables and the cursors declared over here. VDNO, that is emp.dpteno percent type, to accept the value of department number, the rows of which the user wants to update, with the increment that has been declared over here. This burden, because the program wants us to report the burden falling on the company as a result of granting the increment to the employees. Then obviously, because the update statement is going to be there, we are going to use the request for the lock. That is what exactly I was talking about, that explicit cursor which is included over here. and it, this part has already been covered in the explicit cursor also, and because we are going to use it over here, I have also included in this video a little bit explanation of it. The explicit cursor has been used with for update no wait clause to obtain the exclusive locks on the rows which are supposed to be updated by our update statement, and so you are supposed to create the pragma exception over here for the error -00054, and this is the user defined exception associated with this error now, because this error actually gets raised automatically when if some other session has already acquired the locks on the rows that you intend to update. So we are including this explicit cursor over here. Now begin, then VDNO, that is accepting the department number value as an input from the user, then increment value, and here we are opening the cursor so that this select statement embedded with this associated with this C1 cursor will get, and this is parameterized cursor, and so it will automatically get executed, this select statement over here, and as a result, if the locks have not been gained by other session, then the locks will be obtained by this. In case of locks gained by the other session already, then there will be when LCK then, and this message will be printed to the user, that is rows are locked, try later. But if successfully locks are gained, then this update emp set sal equals to sal plus increment, where dptno is equal to vdno, so that is the department number we are getting, and so that is getting updated. If at all this department number is correct, then SQL percent row count will surely be greater than 0, then only it is possible that we can calculate the burden, and that burden will be equivalent to the increment amount into the number of rows updated. Now here you can observe that the percent row count attribute is preceded with the cursor name SQL. Remember that when you are dealing with the implicit cursor, the generic name SQL is used for the name of the cursor, because we have not declared it, and so we have not provided any name. So generic name is used for the purpose of or for referring to the implicit cursor. And so here to get how many number of rows updated, SQL percent row count has been used. Accordingly, DBMS output dot put line, the total burden is displayed over here, because we are capturing the value of burden over here. Else, that is, if the department actually provided by the user doesn't exist, so there is no question of any rows getting updated, and so DBMS output dot put line, the department does not exist, so this message will be printed. After all, we have to close the cursor, and then this is the exception section. As usual, we will see the execution of this program. So enter the department number, say I enter the department number 30, say increment say is 100, then you can see that the total burden is 600, that is probably there are 6 rows in the department number 30, and so each of them is getting the the increment of 100, and so the total burden falling on the company is 600 as a result of that increment. So this is how we have demonstrated the use of the implicit cursor over here in the form of an update statement and an attribute applicable to it in the form of SQL percent row count. But see, actually in this case we were updating all the rows in the set, in the said department, but there can be some such problem where you are required to deal with one row at a time in the implicit cursor. I will just modify this above problem in a little bit different way. So here I am having the problem statement. In the above problem, if it is required to limit the increment to only such employees who do not cross a certain specified limit. So we are actually bringing in an important aspect of this update, a condition that after the grant of the increment, the employees should not cross the specified limit of the salary as determined by the company. So then you will require to test each row. If it is granted an increment, then will it cross the limit or not? And so you are supposed to deal with one row at a time to update, to only update such rows which do not cross the limit, and then to skip all such rows who are not found eligible for an increment. That is what exactly has been said. For those who are not found eligible for this criteria, then they have to be skipped. So this is the program. Again, I will copy the code of this program. We will take it to the Oracle environment over here. Okay. Again, there are some variables. Actually, those many of those variables are same as the above. VDNO, INCR. This is a new variable to capture the value of limit. This is a new the new variable to capture the rows that were updated. This is new variable RNUPD to capture the rows that were not updated for the employees not being eligible for the increment. Other things are same as the above problem. This pragma exception and this explicit cursor, etc., to obtain the logs. Now we proceed on to the executable section. We are now taking the three values as input from the user. First is the department number, then increment value and the limit, obviously, because the problem says that the salary should not cross the specified limit as entered by the user. And here is that cursor. We are now required to use loop. In the previous case, we are not required to use loop because all the rows were required to be updated irrespective of, because there was no any condition of limit over there. Here we are counting the rows processed by the for loop, and that is by the cursor C1, that is cursor, explicit cursor over here. So C1% row count. So in every iteration, this C1% row count will increment by 1, and RUPD will get incremented accordingly. And here we are applying the condition: if var dot sal plus INCR less than limit, then only we are supposed to update. That update emp set sal equals to sal plus increment where current of C1. This is an important clause that we are supposed to learn. When we are coordinating the update with a particular row over which the current pointer is set in the explicit cursor, then we are required to use the current of clause referring to that particular cursor in which the row, the particular current row, is getting updated. So this update will get only targeted at the current row and not to all the rows as it was in the previous case or in the previous problem. So this where current of clause is very important. But when we talk about this where current of clause, remember that this where current of clause can only be used with an explicit cursor having for update and this clause over there. And if there is no locking cursor you are using, then there is no where current of clause you can use in the update. Actually, we are using an update statement over here. The where current of clause can also be used with the delete statement. Remember that where current of clause is used to target our DML, our implicit action, over the current row held by the explicit cursor. And so this where current of clause is very important. Else, that means that if the var dot sal plus increment is greater than limit, then such an employee is not eligible, and so his name not updated is getting printed over there, and then RNUPD, that is that row not updated, is getting incremented. And this is how actually the loop will continue. So RUPD will contain the number of rows that were processed by the cursor, whereas RNUPD will contain the number of rows that were not updated because of the crossing the limit. So finally, after the loop, we are considering RUPD colon equals to RUPD minus RNUPD, that is we are capturing the number of rows that were actually updated in the same variable RUPD, and then we can calculate the burden using the number of rows updated, that is RUPD, into increment, and then we are printing a series of DBMS output dot put line statements where we are printing the burden, then how many rows that we are updated, and then how many rows that we are not updated as a result of not being eligible for the increment, as they have been crossing the limit specified by the user. We will again execute this. I will input the department number 30, then the value for the increment say 200, and say value for the limit is say 1750. I am just taking an arbitrary value over there. Then let us execute, and you will see that yes, Blake and Turner are said to be not eligible for the increment because their salary is crossing the limit of 1750, whereas three employees are getting updated and three employees are not getting updated, and that is the 600 is the increment burden falling on the company as a result of this increment. I will say rollback because I don't want to retain any change for this exercise that we have done. One more thing about the where current off and the for update coordination over here is that within the loop, I say within the loop, you cannot use a commit statement within the loop. Of course, after the loop, you can do that. So it is not possible in such case to commit one row that has been updated as the loop updates one row at a time. It is not possible to just commit that with the help of for update no wait and where current off clause with the coordination of that. Otherwise, it will give you fetch out of sequence error in that case. And you have to use, if at all the commit is required to be used in such program, you have to use it after the end loop statement and not within the loop. So that is also one of the very important aspects of, you have to remember this for the interview, because people ask this particular question in the interview. So and that error, remember that it is called as fetch out of sequence error, because that message is something like that, fetch out of sequence, and so the error is known by that same name. So if the interviewer wants to know from you if the commit can be used, then you can actually tell him about this. I told you already that update statement, instead of update statement, the where current off can also be used for the delete statement as well. That's all in this topic. Keep on visiting the channel for new updates and lessons. Subscribe to this channel if you have not done it so far. Also, please share it generously to help knowledge reach to all those who need it. Thanks for watching.